they explain that patriotism is absolutely essential for motivation, and that the good doctor or officer or medical officer should appeal to every strong belief that the soldier had to try and get them to return to the front line. But they explain, when Bill Smith receives his first uniform, he must face an entire alteration in his living conditions. His contacts are different. He's shorn of many personality props of the friends and relatives of a lifetime. They are replaced by new faces and strange voices. Soon he learns that he is fettered and frustrated by disciplinary restriction. His soul belongs to the army. For both married and unmarried, there's a modification of the sex routine. For some, the change is towards continence. Others are snared in the net of promiscuity with its attendant worries. The conditions of military life are calculated to stir into activity repressed homosexual tendencies, resulting in the development of anxiety states or paraphrenic psychoses. Even the alcohol and tobacco habits partake of this change. There is a move from teetotalism towards drinking, often to excess. Tobacco becomes almost a necessity. So they start this book by explaining that fear reaction is a normal accompaniment to danger. Fear is normal, and therefore what was being called shell shock, and since then has now become generalized to post-traumatic stress disorder. This developed as a reaction to terror and nightmares and anxiety attacks and so on. This is post-traumatic stress disorder, as it's called now, or PTSD. This, in the First World War, was called shell shock. In the Second World War, they did explain that it's not just shells that cause this kind of anxiety. The dangers of military life or warfare cause anxiety and depression. So what is the treatment that they were suggesting? This is where a lot of the treatments that they suggested were influenced by Freudian psychoanalysis, but there was a fair amount of common sense in there as well. So they say that subtitles are investigation, cooperation of the patient, personality of the physician, treatment technique, and these are the treatment techniques: persuasion, therapeutic suggestions. Right, persuasion and therapeutic suggestions are very important, and they were saying you make the suggestion that the person is well, and if you make the suggestion that the person is well, people will feel better and be able to return to work. In this case, it was fighting the war. Now, the psychiatry model since then has started doing exactly the opposite, which is to convince everybody that they're ill. Now, there is no more upsetting label than to tell someone that they have a sick mind. And a sick mental illness means a sick mind. And the current model is saying that the 5% or so of the population who have been labeled with serious mental illness have more sick minds than the people running the system. I would maintain that that is not the case at all, because the people running the system, apart from the economic calamities that they have brought upon us by constant warfare policing of people coming in boats being locked up for processing, to the treatment of Aboriginal people where they send in the army to try and stop abuse within Aboriginal families and abuse of alcohol when the army is renowned and notorious for its problems with alcohol. These are just a few of the ways in which this militarization of medicine, when after the Second World War it was carried to the general, broadened to the general population, the same techniques. One of the things that was left out was persuasion and therapeutic suggestions. And also the next one, which is simple analysis in the waking state. This is where the officer listens to what the person is saying and gives helpful suggestions. They also mention enlisting the cobber. Now, a cobber is an Australian term for a mate or a friend, or someone that can be depended on by the soldier. So the soldier has got peer group support. Okay. then they get to the real therapy, which is what needs to be done to people who have been labeled with schizophrenia or mania or serious depression. And these people need to be sent back to base, where they are given convulsion or shock therapy. At that time, it was done with an injection of a convulsant drug, something I think they used to use, cardiazole and metrazole, which caused convulsions. That was called shock therapy. Then there was narcotherapy, which was putting people, it subsequently became notorious as deep sleep therapy. The next one is called physiotherapy, but it's nothing like what we're talking about nowadays when we talk about physiotherapy. They meant physiotherapy meant electric shocks. And then isolation, where the mad person is kept away from everyone else, and they say it's a low stimulus area, like I was locked up in the LSA, or low stimulus area. Or the same thing they call it over here in PA Hospital, the AOA, the acute observation area, which is supposed to be a low stimulus area. Now, low stimulus area means that it's a prison where there's absolutely nothing to do. And it is well known that boredom drives people mad. And yet they use boredom as a calculated strategy. So that's isolation. It's a punishment, in other words. And then occupation and re-education. I'll leave it there. Occupation and re-education. Well, of the occupation during the Second World War, when The Nervous Soldier was written, the occupation was fighting the Germans and the Japanese and the Axis powers. And if you can see some similarities with modern psychiatry and the Axis of Evil and George Bush's strategy for combating the bad guys, and Dick Cheney's and Donald Rumsfeld and Paul Wolfowitz and all these fellas, well, it's because this was the beginning of the Cold War, and modern psychiatry developed during the Cold War. And my contention is that what they call biological psychiatry is actually an aspect of biological warfare, using chemicals, and it's chemical warfare, psychological warfare, and biological warfare, all integrated into one thing. And this sounds like a very conspiratorial view, and I'm asking for trouble with the diagnosis of schizophrenia hanging over my head. But I would ask people to check out the MK programs, MK, and MK Ultra, MK Naomi. It's, you can find it on Wikipedia. And you find that during the Cold War, there was an integration of psychological, chemical, and biological warfare programs, and this involved the most prestigious universities in the world. And these universities worked hand in hand with the World Health Organization and the United Nations, and it included universities in Australia and the USA and Canada and Great Britain and Europe and Japan. And the MK programs were an Anglo-American mind control programs and behavior control programs. They were developed during the time of behaviorism, and they were very scientific in their approach within the constraints of the behaviorist paradigm. So the next clip that I make, I think I'm going to talk a little bit about what I have found out about the MK programs. But I suggest that you have a look at it yourself, because I figure that the MK programs have a massive bearing on modern psychiatry and general medicine as well, and medical training. And thanks for watching my YouTube.